Welcome to the presentation on Accelerating Spherical K-Means at the CSOP 2021 conference. I will first begin with the standard K-Means algorithm that everybody should know. It minimizes the sum of squared deviations of each point x from the cluster center mu. Spherical K-Means is a variation of this idea from 2001, which maximizes the sum of cosine similarities instead. So instead of minimizing the squared Euclidean deviation, we want to maximize the similarity of each point to its center using the cosine similarity. Now, for simplicity, we are just going to assume that all points are normalized to have a norm of 1. Then these equations simplify a lot. And then we can easily see that if we expand the squared Euclidean distance, we can have an equivalency between these methods as long as these vectors have a norm of 1. Minimizing the squared deviations is the same as maximizing the cosine similarities. And because of that, we have an equivalency between these objectives. We can actually convert one score to the other. So spherical k-means is k-means on normalized data and using normalized means. And that is also what makes the essential difference between the two algorithms. The standard algorithm for spherical k-means closely resembles that of standard k-means. We choose initial cluster centers by some heuristic. We assign each point to the most similar cluster center because it's just simpler to compute the similarity instead of the distance. And then we recompute each cluster center and we normalize it to have a unit length of 1. So we don't take the regular mean, but we take the mean of the points and then we scale it such that it has a length of 1. And then we can repeat step 2 and 3 until no point is reassigned and the clustering has converged. Computing the cosine similarity can be faster than computing squared deviations, squared Euclidean distance, if our data is sparse, because computing the scalar product, we can skip over all entries that are 0 in at least one of the two vectors. So we can do a merge and compute this faster. Now, if the cluster centers move only very little, which they will do after at least 2 or 3 iterations, the clusters don't change a lot anymore, then we do a lot of repetitive computations in step 2 that we would like to avoid. In step 2, we have to compute all n times k similarities, or in Euclidean standard k-means, all n times k distances. Avoiding some of them means our algorithm becomes faster. For standard k-means, there are 2 very, very important algorithms for this. One is Elkans and the other one is Hamerly's, which builds on Elkans' work. And these are milestones in accelerating k-means. Elkans has the idea of using an upper bound for the distance to the current cluster and a lower bound for the distance to each other cluster. And the basic idea of Elkans is if the upper bound for my current cluster is less than the lower bound for any other cluster, then there's no need to recompute the distances because my current cluster is still guaranteed to be the closest, closer than all the others. Elkans also looks at the pairwise distances of centers to avoid some more computations, and it needs additional memory. And that is the main limitation of Elkans' algorithm, that my memory cost increases from m times 1 to n times k plus 1, and this k choose 2 for the pairwise distances. So if I have a large number of clusters, Elkans will also need a large amount of memory, and I need to update all these values. Hamerly simplified this by using only a single lower bound, which is the lower bound of the distance of the point to all other cluster centers that it is not assigned to. And of course, this bound will be slightly worse than the Elkans bound, but I only have one of them and only need to update one of them. So my memory cost is not linear in n times k anymore, but it's only linear in n and in k independently. But I need to do more distance computations. So sometimes one is better, sometimes the other one is better. But usually with a small enough K and only a few iterations, a single bound tends to be pretty good. The intuition of these algorithms that you need to remember is the idea of having an upper bound for the distance to the current cluster. So a value where I can guarantee that the true distance is smaller, and a lower bound for the distance to all other clusters, a value where I can guarantee that the true distance to any other cluster is larger than this. And as long as these don't overlap, I'm fine and I don't need to compute distances. Hamming-Lee's k-means, which is kind of a bit simpler, that's why I'm going to go in more detail here, uses only these two bounds. So initially, the upper bound is initialized with the distance to the current center, which is an exact value, so it's an upper bound. And the lower bound is initialized to the minimum of the distances to all clusters j that the point is not assigned to. A of I indicates in which cluster the point is. So using the old centers, I know that the upper bound is at most as large as L. So my closest center is at most as close as the second closest. Now, when I move these centers, I recompute their positions. I can compute how much the centers have moved, the distance from the current center to its previous location, and now I can update these bounds. And I have to be pessimistic to make sure that I have an upper bound and a lower bound. So I'm going to increase the upper bound by the amount that my closest center has moved, and I'm going to decrease the lower bound by the maximum distance any of the other centers has moved. Then I can still guarantee that the upper bound is an upper bound for the true distance to my current center, and the lower bound is guaranteed less than the distance to all other centers. And now, as long as U of I is still less than L of I don't need to compute. Only if they overtake each other, the bounds, and do no longer guarantee that this is the case, then I have to recompute my distances. And there are some small tricks in Hamming-Lee that how I can avoid some distances. For example, I'm going to first update my upper bound only because I only need one distance computation for this. And then I have a new value of U of I that still needs to satisfy the condition. And then there are some additional pruning rules based on pairwise separation of clusters, but I'm not going to go into detail on them today. Now let's look at this in an example. This is a fairly small data set. I have two clusters. I chose two random objects as initial cluster centers. So that's the object at 7 and 9 and the object at 1 and 5, which have a slightly larger symbol there and where the arrows point to. And every object is assigned to the nearest cluster center. And now I'm interested in whether I need to recompute in the next step some of the distances. My cluster centers will then afterwards move. But for each point, I can now compute the bounds first. So the lower and upper bound of the point at 7, 7 is that I have an upper bound for my nearest center of 2, and I have a lower bound of a much larger value to the point on to the center at 1 and 5. And similarly, for the point in the bottom right, I have such bounds, and you can already see that these two bounds are much closer, so they are more likely to be violated. Now I have these bounds. I have them for all of the points. I only showed two of them. Now my cluster centers will move. I compute the average of each of the two sets, and I can compute the distance, how far my cluster centers moved. And I can use these two distances to update my bounds. So for the point that we first looked at, the point at 7 and 7, I have to increase my upper bound, that's the blue circle, of the distance to my current center. And you can see that we very much overestimate this distance because the center moved towards us and we assumed it moved away from us, the worst case. And we have the lower bound to the other cluster, which is reduced. But you can see there's still some gap between the two thick lines. So I still know that the lower bound to the other cluster center is larger than the upper bound to my cluster center. So I do not need to do any distance computations for this point. I know it remains assigned to the blue cluster. This is different if I look at the point in the bottom right. Here the two bounds are much closer, and now if I move the lower bound away and I move the upper bound the upper bound away and the lower bound closer to us, they overtake each other. And for this point, I can no longer guarantee that the current cluster is the nearest, because it could have moved all the way to the top. So this one point is actually the only one in this data set that I need to recompute the distances for. And it suffices to compute the distance to its current cluster. So I only need one distance computation for this entire iteration of k-means, plus the two distances that the cluster centers moved. So that's three distance computations in total. But the dataset has 8 points, so I would have had to compute 16 distances with the regular k-means algorithm. So I did save quite some work here. That's the basic idea of Hamerly's algorithm, and Elkann's algorithm is, in this case, with two centers identical. If I have more centers, the two algorithms differ slightly. This requires that we have the triangle inequality. We use the triangle inequality to prove that the lower bound and the upper bound in this algorithm are correct. The squared Euclidean distance does not satisfy the triangle inequality, but we can use the regular Euclidean distance in these algorithms. There comes at a slight cost because we have to compute the square roots. In regular k-means, we do not have to, but that's okay. That's additional cost, but it's affordable. So if you wanted to use this with cosine similarity, then we need to use some version of cosine similarity that satisfies the triangle inequality. One choice would be to use the square root cosine, which is equivalent to the Euclidean distance of the normed vectors. And since we are working with normalized data, it is essentially using Euclidean distance. But if we are computing it this way, there is the subtraction operation in here. It has a numerical problem known as catastrophic cancellation. So we probably should not be using the Euclidean-based approach here. Instead, a better choice would be to work with the arcus cosinus, which also will give us a triangle inequality, actually a stricter inequality. But unfortunately, computing the arcus cosines is more expensive, much more expensive. It takes a lot more CPU cycles to compute this function. So neither of them is really attractive to use. One has numerical problems, and the other one is slow. So we wanted to be a bit better. And at the CISAP conference this year, we also introduced a new triangle inequality for the similarities themselves. And this is what we are going to use in this algorithm. So we proved the following two inequalities. We need both of them, one for the upper bound, the other one for the lower bound. And we showed that you can update or can estimate the similarity of a point X and Y if you know the similarities to another point Z. And here, one of them would be the current cluster center, and the other one would be the previous location of the cluster center. So we have the similarity here, interestingly, in contrast to the regular triangle inequality, we do have a product here when you're working with the cosines. And then we have a correction term. And it's easy to see that in the later part, if either of the similarities is one, this correction disappears. And we get inequality actually in here. So now we have a different version of the triangle inequality that works with cosines directly. So now we can rewrite the algorithms of Elkann and Hamerly and probably some of the other k-means acceleration algorithms to work with similarities instead of working with distances. That changes a lot of the logic subtly, and we have to rename everything to make it consistent, because an upper bound on a distance will now become a lower bound on the similarity. A lower bound on a distance becomes an upper bound on the similarity. So to have a meaningful naming, we need to rename a lot of things. And of course, we need to update the equations, but that's all is fairly technical. In these algorithms, we now maintain bounds that satisfy the lower bound of an object of I is less than the similarity of this object to the center the object is currently assigned to. We have an upper bound, that's the one used by Elkann, between an object I and another cluster center J, which is guaranteed to be larger than the similarity between the point I and the center that it is not assigned to usually, the center J. And we have the Hamilly bound, which is an upper bound of an object I that is guaranteed to be at least as large as the maximum similarity of the object Xi to any other cluster center J, except the one that we used for the lower bound. And now if we know that the lower bound is larger than some upper bound, then by just using these bounds that we as we defined them, then we know that the similarity of X to its current cluster is larger than the lower bound, is larger than the other upper bound, and hence larger than the similarity of X to some other center CJ. So as we know that the similarity is larger, we don't need to recompute this, as long as the lower bound is larger than the upper bound. That's exactly as it was in Hamilly, except that all the directions change, upper bounds became lower bounds, and less than became larger than. Now, using the triangle inequalities that I showed on the previous slide, we can get new update rules for our lower and our upper bounds. A lower bound is updated with the similarity of the current cluster center to its previous location. This is the term P of AI here. AI is the assigned cluster of object I, and it's the similarity, how much it moved. And if the cluster center did not move at all, P will be 1. And it's easy to see that the square root at the right side also disappears because we have a 0 in there. And hence, if the cluster center does not move, the lower bound does not change. That's good. And similarly, we have to update the upper bounds. I'm only showing the equation for Elkann's version here. If you want to use it as Hamilly, you need to put in a max and a min in here. Again, it's depends on how much the other center moves. If the other center is stable, the bound does not change. If the other center changes a lot, the bound will usually become very small. And then we will need to recompute, which is fine because the other center moved a lot. And with these replacement equations to update the upper and lower bounds, we can essentially now run Elkann's algorithm and Hamilly's algorithm on spherical k-means. In the paper, we also discussed some smaller optimizations. We discussed some simplified versions of both of them, where we skip some of the checks, because it has been observed before that they don't work very well on high-dimensional data, and that is where spherical k-means is of interest. We also discussed spherical k-means plus plus, better way of choosing the initial centers than random sampling, and we also discussed some differences between high and low-dimensional data and large and small data sets, because the best algorithm depends on the data set characteristics, as we will see on the remaining slides. So some experiments. We need to be aware that reducing the number of similarity computations does not necessarily reduce the runtime if we have some overhead. And that is actually what is happening here. And we also need to be aware that the behavior of the algorithm can change over time, because initially a lot of things will change. So initially we have to recompute a lot. And after some iterations, when the results are mostly stable, we need to compute less. And now if you look here at the similarity computations, the left-hand side is the computations per round. On the right-hand side is the cumulative version, and the standard algorithm that computes everything every round, of course, it has a constant value on the left side and a linear result on the right-hand side. We have a green and a yellow line that are barely distinguishable. That's Elkann's version and the simplified version of it. And we have the red and the violet line, which is Hamerly's, and they kind of sit in between. So they do save a lot less similarity computations. On the right-hand side, we can see that the total is only saving about half of them. So from this plot, it may appear that Elkann's algorithm is much better than Hamerly's because it saves many more distance computations. But this does not come for free because we have k times as many bounds to maintain and to update. If we instead look at the time per iteration, we can see that the standard algorithm is fairly stable. It has some Java warm-up on the left-hand side, but afterwards it is fairly stable. And we can see in the first iterations, all the algorithms will be more expensive than the standard algorithm. But after 10 iterations, all of them are cheaper. And now the difference between Hamerly's and Elkann's algorithm is not as big anymore. We can see that the simplified Elkann's algorithm takes more time per iteration, which is depends on the data, as we will later see. But we can also in particular see that Hamerly's on the long run becomes much cheaper. Once the single bound is enough to prune, it's cheaper. If using k bounds allows us to save half of the computations, and Hamerly would need to compute everything, it's more expensive. So if you look at the cumulative runtime, the difference between Elkann's and Hamerly's has become pretty small. And if you apply this on different data sets, you can get very different results. Here I'm looking at a data set obtained from DBLP, so it's not actually text, but it's kind of a community detection task. We make a matrix that contains authors and conferences, and there's an entry in there whenever an author has published at a conference. And we can use this on one hand to cluster the authors and try to identify author communities that go to the same conferences. On the other side, we can also try to cluster conferences to identify subdomains based on the people attending the conference. And of course, we have many more authors and fewer conferences. So if I'm using the authors as my rows, then I have a larger N and a smaller D. And on the right-hand side, it's the opposite. On the left-hand side, we have a lower dimensionality. Hamerly and simplified Hamerly are much better. They run roughly, well, depending on K, can be twice as fast as standard K-means. But it depends, of course, also on the number of clusters. Simplified Elkann and Elkann's algorithm are much more expensive here than the standard algorithm, which is surprising. But we have to maintain all these expensive bounds. On the right-hand side, the image is quite different. Now we have fewer observations and higher dimensionality. So every similarity computation becomes more expensive. They also tend to be a bit more densely in this data set. So computing the pairwise distances of my clusters means I have k squared distance computations per iterations to do in Elkann and in Hamerly, unless I'm using the simplified versions. And here you can see that the simplified versions suddenly shine. In particular, simplified Elkann, that was the worst on the left-hand side, so the worst in low dimensionality. Now suddenly on the right-hand side becomes the best when I have a very high dimensionality and a large number of clusters. So depending on your dataset characteristics, one algorithm may be better or the other algorithm. And this is the literature I referenced in the talk, but please refer to the paper.